Okay, we are now starting lesson 9. It means we are two-thirds of the way through the book. Okay, I'll run through the grammatical points. This is on page 124. Okay, first here we have a type of noun which in Pali ends with AR. It's based on, in Sanskrit we have this type of noun ends with that R with a dot under it. Like we have Sanskrit, that noun would be represented like this. This is Sanskrit, not Pali. But in Pali, we don't have this type of sound. We don't have this. It's shastra. So it becomes transformed into AR. So the word sastra would be in Pali, sattar, which means the teacher. Teacher in the sense of jiao shu. No, not lao shu. Jiao shu. The founder of the religion. It's jiao shu.
Founder of a religion is jiao shu.
Well, maybe I should have kept quiet. Like the lord or master of the religion. Jiao shu. Jiao shu. I said jiao shu. Jiao shu. Jiao shu. Jiao shu. Jiao shu. Okay, but you never, in Pali, you never get an AR. So what happens is that the AR turns into a long A. Satta. There are a few other nouns that belong to this class. I'm trying to think of some. One would be based on the root karoti, to do. We get a noun. Katar. It's not very common. We give katta, doer, doer, one who does. I think in theory we could get one. Vatar meaning speaker. Speaker is from the word bachati, from the verb bachati, to speak. Okay, then you could say that in the declension, the AR is preserved. So you have the accusative sataram. In some other cases, you say satara ablative. But in other cases, they don't retain the AR. You just have to learn to identify these forms when you see them. Don't try to memorize the declension box. But just be able to recognize. The more common ones would be the nominative singular satta is the most common. We have come across this in the verse of homage to the Buddha, satta deva manusanam, teacher of gods and humans. Then sattu or sattuno is pretty common, the genitive. We have the expression sattu sasana. That means the message of the master, of the teacher.
In what form will we find in the dictionary for this type of word?
I think it would be listed under the nominative.
With the long A?
I think so.
Okay.
Bante, you talk about the sattu sasalam, right?
Yeah.
It means the message of the teacher.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Or the teaching of the teacher. In other words, the Buddha's teaching. Somebody who has understood the teaching, it said that he or she is vinyata sattu sasana, one who has understood the teaching of the master.
What was the other
sutta? Satta deva manusanam. Then there's a similar class of nouns which are used for people who stand in close family relationships to oneself. These are especially father and mother. They're given here. Father is masculine, mother is feminine. We have satusasana at satusasanang is on the top of page 125. Okay, so the most common relationship nouns, those relationships. Pita, originally it's pitar, which becomes a nominative pita, and matar, which becomes mata. Again, you just have to get somewhat familiar with the declensions of these and be able to, you don't have to memorize, but be able to at least recognize when you come across them. If you can't do that, then to refer back to these tables, declension tables. And now we come to another type of past tense. The past tense is called aorist. We already had two types in lesson 6.7, section 7. It's called the aorist and the root aorist. Now here we have something called the s-aorist. And when they give the abstract grammatical explanations, and I don't understand it, but when I see an example and I realize what's going on. So the example is the verb is from the root su, which means to hear.
Thing.
Usually we get in the present su noti. Su nati. That's the present tense. But this type forms the aorist. Often, but not always, you get, remember the, what they call the augment, the a augment. This comes at the beginning of the aorist. And often it identifies a verb form as aorist. And then you would generally add the endings directly to a form based on the root. Instead of taking the stem like this, this would be the stem. But here, one adds the terminations directly to the root, which is su. But the s gets doubled because if it was based on Sanskrit, the root was shru. So the sr, when you add the a to it, the sr turns into a double s. So it becomes asu. But then for certain forms, in the singular forms, the U gets strengthened, intensified to become an O for this one. So we have a so-sing, first person singular, a so-see, second person singular, a so-see, again, third person singular. But in the plural, you could see the root su is preserved. Thus we have asumha, asuta, asosum.
Why did we have the h? Why was the h added? Just because it's first person.
The h, this is just part of the first person plural termination. That's the actual termination.
Okay.
This is second person plural, the termination. T-T-H-A.
Mm-hmm.
And third person plural, it's sum.
So the plural doesn't change to O?
No, the plural keeps the U. And notice also with the verb karoti, which means to do, that also can form this type of aorist. We have the augment A. The ordinary root for this is kar. But here it gets simplified to a ka, And then the termination, sing, see, are added. But in the plural, it turns into a kamha, because you can't have this combination. Too strong a sound for Pali. Too strong, because this has, here you have two consonants joined together, so that makes a very strong syllable. And then when you have a long vowel, that also strengthens the syllable. So it would just be too strong a combination. I don't think in Pali you would ever find a long vowel followed by two consonants.
Akasing is
the
singular, right?
Akasing
is the singular.
Akasing is
the
singular.
Singular, and it's the first, right?
The first person.
And then Akasi, second person, singular. How about the third person?
Third person is the same as the second. Okay. Akasi. Okay, then there's a class of verbs which form their present tense stems in E. An example of this is deseti, to teach. Okay, and these verbs often form their past tense with this type of past tense. So we have this example, deseti, to preach. First person, singular, they say sing. Second and third person, the same, they say see. But in the plural, you see, e is a contraction of aya, just as o is a contraction of ava. So to form the plural, we take the form desaya. You know, we add the plural endings to desaya. So it becomes desayimha, desayita, desaysun, desayings. The third person plural can take either of these, desaysun or desayingsu. Desayingsu. Again, it's something you have to get familiar with as you come across them. Don't worry, it looks so complicated when you see it laid out like this. But that you regularly encounter only a few forms. Generally, the most common is third person singular, sometimes third person plural. And when you encounter forms you can't immediately recognize, oh, I'm going to make a photocopy. In the A.K. Waters book, there's a table which gives all of the most important verbs and then the basic forms of those verbs. I have to make a note to make a photocopy of that for you.
If we have a O stem verb,
yeah,
then it will form another type of aorist. Is that correct? Because evidently we will not have this A-Y-A with the I changing into I. MHA, right? Because here you have and the I came because you cannot have AY.
Yeah, you don't have.
My question is basically, if I have something with O, right now I can only think of Karoti.
Yeah, and Karoti forms its aorist in this way.
So there's not another class of aorists. Then why is this O changing to AVA due to?
It's not in the aorist, but this is just a general thing that one finds in Pali. For example, okay, in Sanskrit we have a verb avalokiti, to look down. That's how we get avalokiteshvara, avalokiti. In Pali, AVA turns into O, so that verb will be olokati.
Okay.
Olokati. It's just because Pali was based on spoken languages, so certain forms get simplified. Just like in literary English we say do not, but in spoken language it turns don't, cannot turns into can't. Okay, the verb gacchati. Okay, we already had one type of past of aorist for gacchati. That's 6, 7.1. Just look on page 87 on the top, and that shows you the declension for gacchati according to the type, the what's called the root aorist. Because it's based upon the root gum for gacchati. But gacchati can also be declined according to the declension system for the upasankami type of aorist. We have that also in, on page 87, section 7.2.
You mean gacchati can follow also upasankami?
The same declension pattern.
Right, it's on the following page. Right. Yeah. So but there are three different types of auras for gacchati.
Two, I only see two. Either the upasankami type, what's called the IS auras, that's on page 87.
And then what's that on page 88? On 126,
is that the same? Is that not, no? Yeah, the one on 88 is the same as the one on page 126.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. I think the one on the top of page 87 is the more common form used in the sutta literature. Okay, then, okay, page, top of page 127. Okay, there's a verb, pati sunati, which means, it's usually used with the meaning to reply to. It comes in a fixed formula, most often a fixed formula. When the Buddha addresses the monks, he says, bhikkhavo, then the monks say, Padante ti te bhikkhu bhagavato paccha sosum. That means the monks replied to the Buddha, paccha sosum. That is the aorist, plural, third person plural.
Paccha sosum, right?
Yeah.
So it's a sort of plural past, right?
Yeah, it's pacha so sum. And the reason, the way this is formed, it takes the prefix pati plus the root su. Su normally means to hear. And pati has the sense of, we say, counter, that is going against. So I guess when you hear somebody speak and then you reply to them, it's like going counter to what they say. So the sense is replying. Okay, but then you have to make the aorist, you get this augment, A. Now when an I and an A in Pali meet, they can't exist to get peacefully together. So first, the I turns into a Y. Just like also in Chinese, when you have the I standing, coming at the beginning of a word as the initial, then it gets pronounced like a Y. Okay, but you never have a TY combination in Pali. When you have TY, it turns into a double C. Okay, that is this side. Then you still have the adding the SU, but the SU really represents Sanskrit shru, So the SR, since you have an SR, there's an R hidden behind this S. And for that reason, to show that, the S gets doubled. It becomes pachaso. And then to that, one adds the third person, plural, and sum. So it becomes pachaso sum. That means they replied. You come across that word hundreds of times.
Pacha sosun. According to the text, it said agreed, assented, right?
So I don't think that's such a good rendering. I think reply is better.
Yeah. Thank you.
Like here, at page 121, the Buddha opens the discourse. He says at the top, he says, Bhagava Bhikkhava Mantesi Bhikkhavoti. The Buddha calls to the monks. He says, O monks, then you have Badante Ti Te Bhikkhu Bhagavato Pacha Sosum. Badante is venerable, sir. Those monks replied to the Blessed One.
How about Te? Te is a though, right?
Te.
Yeah.
Te goes with bhikkhu.
Okay.
It means those monks.
Okay.
So in the case of Patisunati, A goes in between because the Patisunati is a complex verb. Pati plus sunati, that's why A goes in between, not in the front.
No, A goes... Oh, yeah. Yeah, that's an important point. When the A aorist is used and the verb has a prefix, the A augment comes after the prefix and before the actual verb form. Yeah, that's an important point. Rather than saying a pati so su. Okay, then the next grammatical point. That's the future tense. Okay, the most common way to make the future tense is by adding this ISS to the present stem, followed by the present tense endings. So here for bhavati, to be, bhavisami, bhavisasi, bhavisati, bhavisami, bhavisata, bhavisanti. There are some variations on the future tense, but I think they will introduce them gradually. We want to find some examples of other verbs that use a similar... Anyway, there are many, many verbs. Most verbs follow this particular form of the future. But the verb gacchati is something of an exception. Here, sometimes the endings are added to the root to get like gamisati, gamisami. Yeah, I think the root form of the future is more common for gacchati. Gamisami, gamisati. Sunati has an unusual future form, sosati. Okay, now there are also in Pali, as in English, there is a verbs with an active sense. That is where the agent is one who performs an action. But there are also verbs which are called passive verbs, which might be based upon the same root as an active verb, in which something happens to a subject. And the basic key for determining what is a passive is the addition of YA to the stem. So let us take, okay, pach, which means to cook. Pachati. This is active. So you could say, so battang pachati. He cooks rice. But now to the stem, one adds YA to form a passive. But this is where it's tricky, because the Y often gets assimilated to the preceding consonant by doubling that consonant. So you would form the passive stem, pacha. And then when you put a termination on pachati, this would mean is cooked. So you could say battang tena pachati. The rice by him is cooked.
So what is the difference? Oh, it is a verb. What's the difference between passive verb and past participle?
The passive verb is something in the present. It was supposedly in the present.
Right, right.
The rice is being, now it's being cooked by him. It's a, whereas past participle is something which happened in the past.
A passive participle.
I'm sorry. It's a past passive participle.
Okay. I think I got it. Okay.
Yes. That would be in the case of pachitam.
That has been cooked.
Yeah. You could say,
is being cooked by him.
Yeah. If you say battang tena pachitam, that would mean the rice has been cooked by him. The cooking is finished. Okay, another example given here is hanati, means to injure, to go to kill. Then when you put YA to make passive, it gives hanyati. See, when the N and the Y join together, it turns into two N's with a wiggle on the top. Hanyati.
Who was Hanyati again? I'm sorry, I didn't hear.
Hanyati? To kill or to injure? Okay, often to form the passive, instead of using simple YA. This is especially if the stem. Okay, so to form the passive, you would use IYA or long IYA. Okay, deity is to give. From this root is da. So here we have deity is given. That's the passive. You would say food. Okay. Aharam tena deity. Food is given by him. Some other examples given in the book are pujiyati, which means is worshipped, kariyati, is done.
Are most of the passive verbs formed this way?
In what? Yeah, either with directly with YA or with IYA.
Okay. And causative verbs are different.
Causative?
Are they not passive?
Causative are just the opposite of passive. That's where there's a forceful causation from.
Okay, opposite passive, right.
Okay, let's take, okay. Causative verb. Causatives are formed with E or A-Y-A. Okay, pavisati means to enter. Pavi seti, to make enter. Karoti is to do. Kareti is to make, to build or to construct. To speak, one way of saying it is vadati. To make speak, to give an order to somebody else to speak. Vadeti. Pavesati.
Why?
Yeah, part of the causative is the way it formed is by strengthening the vowel of the...
Even before.
Yeah. It doesn't necessarily turn into an E, but it strengthens the vowel of the stem. So an I will turn into an E, a short A will turn into a long A.
Bhante, you say vadati.
Vadati, yeah.
Vadati means to make him say.
No, vadati itself means to speak.
Okay,
vadati.
Vadati.
Means to make speak.
Okay, thank you. What does it mean to make speak?
If I say, especially in the traditional way of teaching, when the teacher, he'll recite something to the pupil, then he wants the pupil to recite back, so he'll say, Vadehi, that's the command, recite back. So he's making the pupil speak.
So normally it will be a second person.
If it's in the command form, yeah. But it could be describing somebody else's action. So the teacher made the pupil speak.
And back to passive verbs, would upajjati?
Oh, that's a good example. Upajjati?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Would that be also a passive verb?
Upajjati is a to arise. This is where it's a little tricky. Upajjati is a verb type which that particular class of verbs forms its nominate, its present tense form naturally by adding the YA. It's not a passive. Just that that class of verbs is formed from YA.
And another word, I don't remember the Pali, I think it's to be freed. To be free.
Muchati.
Muchati.
Yeah.
Would that be also a passive verb? It bothers me when I have a verb that I have I have to find a subject.
Yeah.
And so that would that be that type of verb?
I think that belongs to the same class which naturally forms its stem with YA. But it has, you can see it has a passive sense.
Mm.
Okay, the, say, yoga vacharo muchati, the yogi, the meditator, is liberated. Or, more commonly, tasa chittang asavehi vimuchati, his mind is liberated from defilements. Yeah, so it, naturally it has a passive sense, but one rarely finds an active. So I think that particular, that verb belongs to a class which is formed from YA.
Okay.
But I could show you the difference here between the passive and the causative. Oh, taking mucchati is passive. Yeah, it seems here the stem is munch, but when rarely mucchati. That would be the normal, actually that would be the normal, yeah. This would be the normal present tense of muchati. But one almost never sees it. Instead it sort of gets, its place is taken by muchati, which must originally have been a passive.
What does
muchati
mean?
Muchati is freed.
Oh, okay.
Is freed or is liberated. And then from this, you would form a causative.
Right.
Causative is mochete.
Right.
You see, the U gets strengthened
and
to turn into O,
right.
And you get this E here, which means it gives the causative sense.
Right.
So this means to free, to liberate. Then from upajati. Do you have this? Did you? Upajati means to arise. Like it's chi.
Qi lai,
yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Qi lai. Qi.
Yeah.
Third tone.
Yeah, third tone. Yeah. Very good.
Okay, to make it causative. Upajati. You see, the A gets. You see, upajati comes from. It's based upon a root pud. But then you form that by putting YA. When you have dy, they turn into two j's. Pajati plus upajati. To make it causative, this a gets strengthened by turning into the long a, upa. And the d is retained, and then the stem has the e to make it causative. This means to cause to arise, to produce.
And why do we add up to the root?
That's a prefix.
That's a prefix.
Yeah, the up means
strengthening.
It's a prefix. No, it does. It's not strengthening. Pajati just has a sense of step, like walking. Oop, this prefix. It's actually originally ud, but then when it gets, the d comes up against the p, it turns into a p. Has a sense of up. So originally, upajati was stepping up, and then that takes on the meaning to arise, to come into existence. Okay, shall we go on to the next? Okay, page 128. Now, in an earlier lesson, we learned about the passive participle. This is lesson 4. Did I say passive participle? Present participle. Present participle. 4.4. Lesson 4.4. Yeah. The present participle in mana. Now, one can form present participles based on passive verbs. And they'll always be formed with mana, never with the anto. So whenever you see mana, well, if you see mana, it doesn't necessarily mean that it's a passive verb, but you could be sure when you see mana that it might be a passive verb. When you see anto forms, you're always sure that it's an active form. I'll just have to point out examples when we come across them in the reading. Okay, 6. This is just a declension of one verb for another verb that means goes, yati, usually used for going in the sense of traveling someplace. Not simply going from, say, if I go down to the road to collect the mail, then I would use gachati. If I go into town just to buy some things, I would use gachati. But if I'm making a trip, a long distance trip, then I might use yati. So that with prefixes, we have a number of verbs with prefixes based on yati. To go out, like when somebody leaves a town or city, so the niyati. And then this verb gets used with a religious meaning, going out of samsara, going out of the world. So it comes to mean the act of deliverance. Then Puyati means to set out on a journey. Okay. Any questions about the grammar?
Number 7 is the
Oh, this Kaira.
Kaira.
Kaira,
Kaira.
Yeah. Those are just those are optatives of karoti. Just have to recognize them. They come actually, especially in verse, they come. Not in prose, but in verse.
I have a question.
Yeah.
About the future tense.
Yeah.
Does the ISS ever get changed to ESS?
Okay. Yeah, there is an ESS. Gets the verbs of a class like de sati.
Exactly.
Yeah, it will form the future de sati.
But does it mean that when we have a positive verb,
yeah,
it's always ESS instead of ISS?
Yeah, when it's forming the future.
Could you please explain one more time on the present participle about passive verb? For example, just take one example.
Okay.
Fujiyamana.
Yeah.
So, if you dissect those, Pujati?
Okay, the root is Puj, P-U-P, long U-J. When you form a passive, the regular passive verb, it would be Pujiyati, is worshipped. Okay, but now to form the present participle, that means an action, we're describing an action which is continuing. Pujiyamana, he is being worshipped. Or some action, kairamana. Some action is being done. Any other questions? Okay, then maybe this will be enough for today. Grammar, it's really a dry desert. I like to get into the reading examples, reading passages.
Grammar
is
extremely helpful.
The what?
It's helpful.
It's helpful.
Very helpful.
Yeah.
On page 121 in exercise 9 and section 2, line 4. Why is Eka Sarabhojana? Why is Eka Sarabhojana? And how come one with the little thing that come that like a
they call that circumflex, they call
yeah,
it.
Yeah, circumflex. Yeah. And the one is with a long, short.
Actually, they
change it. Why? Because it's plural or?
No. Actually, they should all have the circumflex.
So that one has to change it to circumflex.
Yeah, that was a sort of typing mistake. Now, the reason why the circumflex is used rather than just the bar.
Yeah.
It means that there's actually two short A's that come together to form a long A. It's Eka plus Asana. Eka is one, Asana is eating or meal. So when the two short A's come together, it's just the way this is represented in English printings of Pali. If it's done in an Asiatic script, like singular, Indian Sanskrit script, Burmese script, it would all be with one way of representing the long A.
So should it be circumflex?
Yeah, okay, like a little roof.
Okay.
One last. How could you say, Pali is being taught by Bante?
Well, you wouldn't say Bhante, because Bhante is actually a vocative.
Oh, okay.
Okay, you would say Pali Bhasa. That means the Pali language. Say Bodhi na Bhikkhuna by Bhikkhu Bodhi. Na is long. I'll write it. That's a feminine noun. Bodhi na, that's the instrumental. By Bhikkhu na, again instrumental. That's the name Bodhi Bhikkhu. Desi amana, this is present participle. Passive, present, I'm sorry, it's present passive participle.
PPL, right?
Yeah. Then hoti is needed to make it like a complete sentence.
You mean that hoti?
Yeah, otherwise you would have to have something else to, otherwise this would just be like a hanging phrase. Mm-hmm. You would say Pali Basa Bodhina Bhikkhuna Desi Amana, then you would have to add something else to describe it.
Why long A for mana?
That's a good question. You see, mana, present participle,
it has to agree with
basa, and basa is a feminine noun with the long A.
So it has to agree with the object. This is the subject. Yeah,
passive, yeah. It's the subject of the passive sentence.
You said it has to have a hoti.
In order to make it
complete sentence.
To make it a complete sentence. You can't just end the sentence with a participle. It's like saying, the man driving the car, or the car being driven by the man. What?
There's no verb. Complete verb.
Yeah. But you say the car is being driven by the man. You put the is in, and then it makes a complete sentence.
So what's the meaning of this?
That sentence.
I mean the English meaning, the Pali
language. The Pali language is being taught by Bhikkhu Bodhi.
Metta mean? M-E-T-T-H-A. Because I did the exercise on page 121 and the section 1 and the number 22. Okay.
Page 121?
Yeah, page 121, section 1 and line 22. And I think it's called Vinaya Cha Santi Santi Metta Metta. M-E-T-T-H-A.
Nitam Eta.
Yeah,
Nitam
Eta.
Oh,
meta.
Okay.
Yeah, what does metta mean? I cannot
find. No, it's it. Actually...
Metta means conclusion, right?
Yeah.
And how about the metta?
Metta. No.
Huh?
It's...
Or is it one word?
No, it's not one word either. It's actually two words, but the break is between M and E. You see, it's nitam.
Yeah. Oh, but I wrote nitta, N-I-T-T-H-A.
Yeah.
Right? And then metta.
No, it's N-I-T-T-H-A-M. Then there's a break.
Okay.
Then eta.
Oh.
Eta means here.
I see.
And the M goes with, of course, with nitam.
Oh, so let me see, number 22.
Yeah.
So I have to change this, right? It's a two word.
That's why I cannot define
yeah.
it. It's one word. It's a compound.
No, it's not really it's a compound. It's no, compound. It's one. It's two words. Mm. It's not a compound.
Nitam eta. Okay.
But the two are joined
here
through what's called sandhi.
Okay. Okay. So it's not a compound. It's sandhi. Yeah.
Yeah.
Sandhi.
Right. Not a compound. Sandhi.
So it should be together, right? Sandhi.
It's just joined to make
joined.
It easy.
Yeah, okay.
Easy for pronunciation.
Here, make conclusion, right? Here's the conclusion.
Right, the conclusion should be, we say, the conclusion should be reached here,
okay.
here in the sense of about this. In regard to this, the conclusion should be reached.
For further readings next time?
Yeah.
Another,
I could even do it now, actually.
I'll try to close
the Hey, wait, you're cheating.
Okay, blame, reject. Okay. I know that. I'm not cheating, I'm just curious.
Yeah, Pati, so
yeah.
You have to recognize reject. It's a negation.
Yeah, reject the blame.
Okay.
Let you rest.
Now we'll go over the glossary on page 130. Yeah, upagatta. Page 130, upagatta. It could also take, it could be meaning gone away from, gone off. And Elias and Mudita, I think they got a wrong reading. About the middle of the page, Elias, it should be two M's. Elias some Mudita. And it means, I would say, rejoicing in desire, rejoicing in attachment. Then just below that, I'll have to explain this. Ida pachayata. This is really, it's an abstract noun, meaning conditionality.
Condition?
Conditionality. The law of conditionality.
Can you put down the ball right down?
The English.
Yeah, condition, I know.
Condition?
Yeah. No.
And then add to it, A-L-I-T-Y.
Oh, okay. Conditionality.
Yeah. Okay, then Kalandaka Nivapa. Kalandaka Nivapa. That means, or usually translated, the squirrel's feeding ground. That was a place, a part of the bamboo grove, I guess, where the squirrels used to go to feed. Then, or Kayasa Beda Parangmarana. After complete death, I'm trying to figure out what is income.
Maybe it's already the.
What is incomplete?
Complete. Not a body. Body passed away. This. I. Everything is gone. So
yeah, I always translate it with the breakup of the body after death. Then the bottom of the page, Garu Karoti. To my knowledge, it always means used in the sense of respects. I don't know if it's ever used to mean consider seriously. I'd have to see an example of that. Then Tato was Tato. Almost always you find that in the form Tata, T-A-T-A, as evocative, meaning something like dear.
With a long.
The first day is long, the second one short.
Okay, vocative.
Yeah. Vocative.
Okay, vocative, vocative.
Not locative, vocative.
Okay.
V-O.
Yeah, vocative.
Yeah.
Means father.
Yeah. not so, it doesn't mean so much father as a dear one. A child might use it to address his father, a father to address the child.
Can we use tata to teacher?
No, no, I don't think it would be used. Nibbana is actually, that's nirvana. Then for pachisosi, they have a sense and agrees. But I would put replies.
Which one? Excuse me, which one? I'm sorry. After nirvana.
Pachisosi.
Where?
About four items below nirvana.
Okay. Pachisosi.
Yeah.
Okay. What does pachisosi mean?
Replies.
Okay.
To answer. When somebody calls you, then you answer back.
Okay.
Then panjalika is he jang, is that what it is? He jang.
Jang is he jang.
He jang.
He
jang.
You were right at the time.
And paticca samuppada, that's dependent origination. Yuan qi.
Yuan
qi, yeah. Patipanna, usually it's used in the sense of practicing, like practicing the path.
You mean practicing?
Yeah, like practicing the path.
The path.
The path, the Buddha's path. Patipanna. Patipanna.
As the past participle?
It's a past participle, but it's used somewhat with the present tense. Like somebody
like
is dhammanu dhamma patipanno, practicing in accordance with the dhamma. Like an adjective.
Stepped onto.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Okay.
Okay, then patta chivara. Patta is bowl, the alms bowl. And chivara is the monk's robe. Then pahina. I don't know how they get calmed for pahina. Pahina is given up. Or abandoned, eliminated. Yeah, Maro, Mara, that's like the devil in Buddhism, the tempter.
The Maro is the death.
It's not so much death as the act of dying, but it's the lord of death.
Okay.
It's usually shown as a person, the one who tries to, when the bodhisattva is sitting under the bodhi tree trying to get enlightenment. Mara is the devil who comes to him. You have vihesa, vexation or trouble. Then sankhara, this is understood as like conditioned phenomena. All things that depend on conditions, causes and conditions. Sakaroti, I usually render it honors, to give honor to. Yeah, then samatha has a sense of the calming down. Yeah, I guess it could also take on the sense of cessation. Okay. Yeah, then just in the reading passage on page 129, number 2, the reading passage number 2, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Sixth line, you have this alaya samudhitaya. There should be two M's, S-A-M-M-U-D-I-T. And that means rejoicing in attachment. Okay.